Hello everyone, welcome to lesson 67 of our Golang course. This lesson is an introduction to concurrent programming in Go. So let's get started with a quick reminder on what concurrency is and what problems it's trying to solve and what are the challenges that we face when we write concurrent programs. So let's get started. What is concurrency? Concurrency can be thought of as executing a program by dividing into multiple parts. These parts may or may not be executed in parallel, but it may give an illusion that they are running in parallel. For example, maybe the parts of the program are sharing their time on a single CPU core, but to human eye, it may look like they are running in parallel. What's the need of concurrency in programming? In general, it increases the performance of running program, but only if you are careful. When we first developed computers, we kept on adding more and more transistors to increase its power until we reached a certain limit. Try and search for Moore's law. Then to expand it further, we had computers with multiple core CPUs. To exploit these resources available to us, modern programming languages introduced concurrency to take it a step further. So this all is being done to increase the performance and get as much as possible out of the resources we have provided by the computer. Now let's write a program in Go that uses Go routines, which is how you write concurrent programs in Go. Don't worry too much if you don't know about Go routines. We will cover that in a later lesson. First, I'm going to create a counter, which is of type int. Next, I'm going to create a loop to increase the counter. Inside it, we will create a Go routine with the keyword Go. So Go, define the function for it, and then call the function at the same time. Inside the function body, we will increment the counter value, counter plus plus. Once we are done with increasing the values, we can print it. So as you can see, I have added two print statements to print the value of a counter after we iterate 10 times and each time we launch a Go routine to increase the counter. Go run main.go. So in here we launch 10 Go routines and each Go routine incremented the counter by 1. At the end, we got 10 as the output, which is what we expected. The code may look good to you, but there's a problem. Let us see that by increasing the for loop count. So let me increase the count to a bigger value. Now let us run our program to see if we can see the problem. Go run main.go. And as you can see, we expected the counter to be 1000, but we got 979. Why did this happen? This is because we were launching Go routines that run concurrently. But here, we are not waiting for the Go routines to end when we print the counter value. As such, some of the Go routines were not completed and they were not able to increase the counter value. This is why we are getting 979 printed. If I run the program again, you will see a different value. See, it's now 976. Run again, 986. So we are seeing that few of the Go routines haven't finished yet. Now, a very silly thing you can do is, we can wait for them to complete by running time.sleep and let us sleep for maybe 10 seconds. So with sleep, what I'm saying is let the program sleep after initiating Go routines and wait for them to complete. Now let us run a program. So we were able to get a bigger number. Now what happens if I increase this counter again? This doesn't work either. So I can keep on increasing the counter. Now it's 30 seconds. Let's run our program again. So after 30 seconds, we are getting counter value to 991. This is closer to 1000, but it is not 1000. So you can see by running concurrent programs, our program is less deterministic, which is a problem as computer programs need to be deterministic so that we don't get any unexpected surprises. We added sleep, but this is not a very efficient way because we increase the probability of it giving a value that we expect, but then again, it's still not deterministic. So instead of solving a problem efficiently, we in opposite decrease our proficiency of a program by adding sleep. So this is one challenge of working with concurrent programming. Let us look at some other challenges. So there are a few challenges that come with concurrency. The most common and most talked about is a race condition. It is when you have two or more of these concurrent programs, or in our case, coroutines, trying to access shared data. For example, it is like me and my sister trying to share a piece of cake. It introduces unpredictability. When I go to the refrigerator, I may see the cake was half eaten when I expected a full piece. This is because me and my sister are competing against each other for the same resource, which in our case was piece of cake. As such, we can't predict who will eat or get the resource first. This means that the order of operation is not deterministic, since we don't know who will eat the cake first. If I get to the cake first, I will get the full piece. But if my sister gets to the cake first, I may be in for a surprise. This may be okay in real life, but in terms of program, this is catastrophic, as computer programs need to be deterministic. So what exactly is atomicity? In computer science, atomicity generally refers to an operation that is indivisible and irreducible. In simpler terms, it means that the operation either happens entirely or not at all. If you have studied databases, database transactions are an example of atomic operation. Why is atomicity important when we talk about concurrent programming? Because it gives us predictable program. By employing atomic operation, we can ensure that critical section of our code, where shared data is accessed and modified, are executed as a single unit. This prevents race conditions and maintains data integrity in computer program. Now let us talk about critical section. The first thing to do is to identify the critical section of your code. What exactly is the critical section of your code? Accessing and modifying shared data is done in critical section, which requires proper synchronization mechanism to ensure only one thread or process can be in the critical section at a time. As such, identifying critical section of our code is very important to write safe concurrent programs. In our program, the critical section of the code is where we access the counter. We can guard the sections with locks. With locks, we can be sure that only one go routine has access to the counter. Let us now modify our code to protect against the race condition. So let me initiate a lock first, var lock, which is exported from the sync package, sync.mutex. We will cover mutexes in a later lesson. For now, let us just go with it. Whenever I am accessing a counter, let me lock it so that only one go routine can access the counter at one time. This can be simply done with lock.lock or mutex.lock. Once we have incremented the counter, let us unlock it so that other go routines can access it. So this is essentially a critical section of our code, and we are protecting against it using locks. Then again on line 24, we access the counter. So this becomes a critical section. Let us use the same lock to lock and then unlock. Now this means that we have prevented against a race condition in our code. That is, only one go routine can access the counter at one given time. Now run our program again. And as you can see, it hasn't resolved the problem where not all go routines are completed. So with this, we solve the problem of race condition for data access, but the second problem of making sure that we get an expected output still remains. We will cover this in a later lesson. So in this lesson, we learned that concurrency can help you with increasing the performance of your program if you are careful, but there are some inherent problems like race conditions and the non-deterministic nature of concurrent programs. So you need to be really careful when writing concurrent programs, which we will cover in the next few lessons. That's it for the lesson. I hope you enjoyed it. Please feel free to ask any questions that you may have in the comments under the video, or reach out to our Discord server. Until next time, happy coding!